good morning, and thank you so much for being here today to worship together. What a beautiful day to be here. And before we begin this morning in song, there are a few items I'd like to share with you. First off, tonight we'll be back here at 6 o'clock, and our young men of the congregation will be leading us in worship. I want to encourage all of you to come back and to encourage these guys who have put a lot of work into preparing to be able to stand before you and to lead in this way. I would also say that it's not just encouraging for them, but will be encouraging for you to be here and to see how blessed the Central family is when it comes to our youth of the congregation. Please also remember that after that, we will have our congregational meeting, and we hope that if you're a member here, that you'll stick around for that. Then, I want to make you aware that beginning next week, next Sunday, we'll be back into our small groups for 4 more weeks, and we'll take on a really important piece to this year's focus on falling in love with Jesus by falling in love with Jesus' people, and that is forgiveness. For 4 weeks, again, beginning next week, you'll hear a lesson and then break off to discuss into your small groups at various locations around town, and we'll discuss in week one, forgiveness and understanding it. In week two, forgiveness and our need for it. In week three, forgiveness and giving it. And then finally in week four, forgiveness and the power of it. As we have stated in the bulletin, this is just a reminder that on this, there is no small group signups this go around. As you'll be in the same group as you were the last time in the last 4 weeks, most recently. And if you did not participate in that last round of small groups and you want to participate this time for this 4 weeks, you can see me or Josh Smith will be waiting for you at the welcome station in the foyer after services to get you plugged in. As we begin our worship here today, I want to encourage you to remember who we are and why we are here. With that, let's worship together.
Still my Precious Lord, take my hand. After this song, we'll go to our Heavenly Father in prayer. When my way groweth drear,
precious Lord, bring your ear. When my life is almost gone, hear my cry, hear my call, hold my hand as I fall. Take my
Father, we come for you, acknowledging you as the great I am, not only the creator of everything, but the sustainer of everything that is good within this world. And we realize that we're here to worship you, to direct our thoughts and our cares before you, to acknowledge you as the great I am, to give you a sense of our appreciation by not only being here, but by focusing on all that you do and mean to each one of us. So we pray that our worship as a congregation will be pleasing. But more than that, we pray that each individual here, by being here, our worship as individuals will be pleasing in your sight. Help us understand better what it means to worship you, that we may worship you at a deeper level, rejoicing in the things that you've promised and knowing that you keep your promises, knowing that you've forgiven us of our sins and have given us a hope for eternal life. And for all of that, we are appreciative. We realize that each act of our worship brings something special to this worship service. So we ask that you would clear our minds and encourage us to participate in each act of worship. Even so far, our singing has been focused on worshiping you, and we desire to worship you at a greater level. We're a large, diverse group, and each of us has different needs. We would pray the Holy Spirit would indwell us during this hour, that we would have our needs met, see directions that you want us to go, and likewise, be willing to accept those times when you say no, that's not the way we should go. We think of all those who are not here, and we pray for them as well. But primarily of this next hour, we ask you to help us focus directly on you and all that you've done for us. And we ask this prayer through your Son's name, Jesus, who did one of the great things in our lives, if not the greatest, in terms of dying for us and opening the door to be considered sons and daughters of yours. For this we're thankful, and it's in his name we ask this prayer. Amen.
For Lord's Supper, communion prayer.
Let me begin this morning by making sure everyone has the emblems that were passed out to partake of the Lord's Supper. If we have anyone that has not received those, I hope you'll raise your hand and we will get them to you right away. You know, sometimes our minds wander. Our thoughts wander, and we get a little bit out of focus with what's taking place because we've done it so long. I don't know how long I've driven a car, but I was riding with my younger brother on a long trip, and we were in his new vehicle. And as we were driving, as he was driving and me sitting next to him, all of a sudden, his vehicle started beeping. He had moved over too close and gotten out of his lane. And I said, does that work both ways? And he said, yeah, when you're not focusing and you're not going directing where you're supposed to go, that happens. And so he moved over just to show me. There was over to the edge and it started beeping. I'd give anything if I could do that with your mind this morning. I'd give anything as New Testament Christians. I did that last week. I did it before. And you know, we really have to put ourselves in a position of preparing our minds so the beeper doesn't go off because of dinner or 2 o'clock or whatever. It'd be a wonderful thing if that would happen, but I'm counting you as a believer in Jesus Christ to get in the lane of thinking just about the Lord Jesus at this time and our obligation to him as a New Testament Christian. And he gives us so many warnings throughout the New Testament of where our mind needs to be when we gather together. 1 Corinthians chapter 11 is a place I'd like to just share with you briefly. And the Apostle Paul, of course, inspired by the Holy Spirit, goes on to say, I received from the Lord that which was also delivered to you. So in a sense, he's saying, God gave it to me and I'm sharing it with you. But you've already had it too, all of you sitting out here. The same night in which he was betrayed, he took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And then in the same manner, he takes the cup after supper, saying, the cup is new, new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Then the apostle goes on to say, for as often as you drink, you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. And I'm hoping that's where we will be focused this morning as we partake of these emblems. Will you bow with me? Holy Father, we pray that we would be focused on the great sacrifice of your Son and pray that you will bless us as we partake of the bread, remembering what it represents, his body given for us. And we pray our minds will be just focused right on him and what he has done for us as we partake of this day. It's our prayer in Christ's name. Amen. Just as our overhead said, the precious blood of Jesus Christ, a lamb without blemish, no spot given for you, the perfect, perfect sacrifice. Will you bow with me as we give thanks for the blood? Holy Father, we are again bowing and giving you thanks for this opportunity to be together to remember the sacrifice of your Son Jesus and the precious blood that was shed for us. We are so thankful for the great example he was to us and the great example he lived, letting his light shine everywhere it was, or everywhere he went. And we're praying, Father, that as we partake of this cup, you will bless us and bless it as we partake. All this we pray in Christ's name. Amen.
No, thou fount of every
blessing, fill my heart to sing thy praise. Rings of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me ever to adore thee.
This time has been set aside for the opportunity to us to remember the great things that God has given us and the abundance of things that God's people have always had placed right at their feet. I go all the way back to the Old Testament, the beginning of mankind. God always had in place some way for his people to return to return to him the blessings that they had given, to recognize a true and a living God. And so that's what we take time to do today. Each of us have been blessed in a different way, and different ways that we have been blessed and different ways we use those blessings. I think all of you would agree we're doing a lot of great things for people everywhere, spreading the gospel by your efforts, our combined efforts together. And you'll be able to hear about some of that tonight as we talk about in our congregational meeting some of the things that our funds collectively are able to do. And it's a beautiful thing to hear and to know about and to know you're part of. So I'm praying that each of us will continue always to be cheerful in what we give, that we will continue to give. It is ordered by God. He even tells us how much he expects from us, not more than we're able to do, but certainly do it in a cheerful manner. So if you're able to, at the end of service as you leave, we've got boxes placed in the back where you can drop that contribution and be able to continue to do the good things collectively that are done from this place. Let's pray together. Our Heavenly Father, we truly are thankful. As we look through our lives, and if we were able to make a ledger sheet of the blessings that we've received from you, certainly we should not be holding back anything. We have an opportunity to give back and to share back. And we pray, Father, that the good work that goes on to spread your kingdom will continue to pour forth, and that I will individually do my part to get that accomplished. We thank you so much for your blessings, all the things you've given us individually, and pray the work of this church will continue to thrive. Thank you for loving us as you have. It's our prayer in Christ's name. Amen.
You can join the parade that'll be going back to a classroom where they will have their worship and instruction. Want to read that verse? Before, but for you who fear my name, the Son of Righteousness will rise with healing in his wings, and you will go free, leaping with joy like calves let out to pasture. Let us stand while we sing this song.
Yeah.
Well, good morning. I invite you to open up your Bibles this morning to Luke chapter 15. We're going to take a closer look at this passage. I talked about it a couple of weeks ago. It's a very well-known passage that the Bible talks about. It's a story that Jesus told about a prodigal. And as we determined and talked about last time, that the word prodigal means wasteful. And so this is a story of a wasteful son, but it's not really just one son. There's wastefulness on the part of both of the sons. And we'll begin reading in Luke chapter 15 and verse 1, though I want you to see the background for this. Then all of the tax collectors and the sinners drew near to him. The him there is Jesus. They were drawing near to Jesus to hear him. And the Pharisees and the scribes complained, saying, "This man receives sinners and eats with them." So he spoke to them this parable. What man of you having 100 sheep? And he tells a story there. And then, or at verse 8, what woman having lost 10 silver coins? And he tells a story. But I want to focus our attention beginning at verse 11. A certain man had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, "Father, give me the portion of goods that falls to me." So he divided them his livelihood, and not many days after, the younger son gathered all together and journeyed to a far country, and there wasted his possessions with prodigal or wasteful living. But when he had spent all, there arose a severe famine in the land, and he began to be in want. And then he went and he joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into the fields to feed swine. And he would gladly have filled his stomach with the pods that the swine ate, but no one gave him anything. But when he came to himself, he said, "How many of my father's hired servants have bread enough and to spare, and I perish with hunger? I will arise and go to my father, and I will say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you, and I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants.' And he arose, he came to his father, but when he was still a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. And the son said, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight, and I'm no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to the servants, 'Bring out the best robe and put it on him, and a ring on his hand and sandals on his feet. And bring the fatted calf and kill it, and let us eat and be merry, for this my son was dead and he is alive again. He was lost and he is found.' And he began to celebrate. Now his older son was in the field, and he came and he drew near to the house, and he heard music and dancing, and he called one of the servants and he asked, 'What do these things mean?' And he said unto him, 'Your brother has come, and because he has received him safe and sound, your father has killed the fatted calf.' But he was angry, and he would not go in. Therefore his father came out and pleaded with him. So he answered and said unto his father, 'Lo, these many years I have been serving you. I've never transgressed your commandment at any time, and yet you never gave me a young goat that I might make merry with my friends. But as soon as this son of yours came, who has devoured your livelihood with harlots, and you killed the fatted calf for him.' And he said unto him, 'Son, you are always with me, and all that I have is yours. It was right that we should make merry and be glad, for your brother was dead and is alive again, and was lost and is found. Now remember, this is a story that Jesus is telling. This is not an actual happenstance of history necessarily, but we can see it play out in different times and different places and different relationships. But this is a story that Jesus tells to a group who are complaining to him that he's hanging out with sinners. He's hanging out with people who aren't right with God. He's hanging out with those kind of people. And so Jesus tells three stories to illustrate what God's view is of those who are sinners or those who are separated from him and not in a right or covenant relationship with him. In verses 11 to 16, the father deals with his selfish son, this younger son. He does give him what he is asking for, and he allows him to go off. In verses 17 through 20, he just wastes everything that he has, all of his livelihood that has been given unto him. And then the father celebrates, verses 20 to 24, when he comes back home. Verses 25 through 30, the older brother refuses to go, but the father pleads with him. What I want you to see with me is, as we look at this deeper, that it's at least a story of two different things that I want to share with you. The first one is the idea of what repentance actually is. Luke chapter 13 and verse 3, Jesus said, "Unless you repent, you will all likewise perish." So it is absolutely critical that we understand what repentance is. I believe this story illustrates it quite well. And there's three key principles that are involved in repentance that I want to share with you this morning, first of all. So what is it? First of all, it begins with reflection. Look again at verse 17, what it says, Luke chapter 15, verse 17. But when he, that is the younger son, when he came to himself, he said, "How many of my father's hired servants have bread enough and to spare with hunger?" I want to suggest to you that repentance is begun. One of the first key principles in repentance is reflection, is to look at where I am, look at my life, look at my circumstances in the sense of saying, so how's it going right now? How's it working out for me? And so here is this young man. He had great ideas, great vision of what he was going to do. And if dad will finally give me my money, I'll finally get to live life like I want to live life. And he goes out and he lives life like he wants to live life. And he's so at the bottom of the barrel, he said, "I wish I was just a servant at home. Not even a son. I just wish that I could be treated as well as my father treats his hired servants." You see, reflection says, how's it going? Where am I at right now? What's it like? How are things working out for me in my life? This personal reflection then leads to a change of mind. This young man says, if I'd have just stayed at home, been a servant, I'd be better off. So here's what I'll do. I'll go back home. I'm not going to go back and ask dad if I can be one of his children again. I've already blown that. So maybe he'll take me in and just be a servant. And therein is the second key note or principle of repentance, and that is a resolution. That we've reflected on our life, we've looked and we've seen it's not where we want it to be. And so we resolve to make something different. And so this young man resolves at verse 18, "I will arise, I will go to my father, I will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Just make me as a hired servant." You see, this change of mind that he has based on the reflection that he's made is no good without a plan. The resolve that he has is not just okay, next time if I'm ever in that situation again, that dad has an inheritance waiting for me, I won't ask for it. that's already passed. That's not an option. So his plan is, he resolves, here's what I will do. I will go back and I will plead my case before my father. But see, there's something very critical that we need to understand about repentance in this point of resolution. Repentance is not feeling sorry. Repentance is not when I say, oh man, I sure blew it. I can't believe I messed up my relationship. I can't believe I messed up at work or whatever it is. So man, I am so sorry that I did this. And maybe even in tears, that's still not repentance. When I feel sorry, because a lot of times that just leads to self-pity and wallowing in self-pity. But there's resolution that goes along with it. It leads to this decision to make a change. So the young man says, I'm no longer content with this situation. I will do something different. I will go back to dad and I'll make this change. And then the third aspect of repentance is in returning. Verse 20 says, he arose and he went to his father. It takes action. Repentance takes action for it to work. It's more than just a feeling. You remember Jed talked a couple of months ago to us about compassion, and he said it, pointed out to us that correctly so, that it's more than just seeing a need. It's more than just feeling a feeling for somebody in that need, but now it takes action. That you see something, you feel something, and then you act upon it. Repentance is similar in that regard, that we reflect, we resolve, and we return, we act on it. That's what repentance really is. It's a change of mind that brings about a change of life. But here's our problem, is that we often skip one or more of these essential stages. Somebody looks at their life because they've made just a bust of things, and their relationship is now falling apart, their marriage or a relationship at work or whatever the case is, and they've just made a mess of all of it. And so they reflect on that and they look at that and they say, I just can't believe I did this. I can't believe I'm in this situation. I can't believe I made this mistake. And they reflect on that and think, okay, I am really sorry that I did this. That's not repentance. You see, you can have reflection and you can have resolve even, but if you don't have any return or change, it's useless. So I might even say, well, I'll never do this again. And then I go right back to the same livelihood, lifestyle and everything else. That's not what repentance is. So if I skip return, that's not going to work. And if I resolve to change my life, and then I go about trying to change my life, but that resolve is not based on reflection, I'm going to leave some things out of it, almost for sure. I might deal with the big issue of whatever this is staring me right in the face, but whatever seven contributing issues led to that, I don't see those because I haven't really reflected on my life. And so if I skip reflection, it doesn't work. And if I reflect and I return, but I don't have any resolve, I'm not going to hang around too long. I make this decision, I'm going to change my life, I've reflected, this is a mess, I'm going to change, I'm going to start tomorrow doing this or not doing that any longer, but I don't have any resolve within me, then it lasts a day, a week, a month, and I'm right back in the same situation. So this young man sets an example for us of what genuine repentance looks like. And so that'd be the question I'd ask you this morning. How's it working out for you right now? How are things? How's your life? How are your relationships? How are your circumstances? Are there some things that you need to reflect on and say, okay, where I'm at right now, maybe it's because I did this and I didn't do that and I went down the wrong road, and I make this serious reflection, will you resolve to make that change? And then will you make the change in return? That's what this young man does, and he sets a great example for us in this. But I want you to see something else about this parable, this story that I think is beautiful that we shouldn't ever miss. And that is what this father is like. We first of all learn that he is more than fair. You remember his son comes to him and in essence says, "Dad, I wish you were dead." That's what he really says. I'd like my inheritance now. Now the father was under no obligation to give him what he asked for, no responsibility to give to him, but the father does. But it even goes further than that. How fair he was before he ever left is what the young man was thinking about while he was in the pig pen. He was thinking about his dad and what he left back home. His dad was more than fair. His father was more than fair in this story before he ever left. And the second thing that we learn, that he loved him before he did, his fond memory of what it was like at home. And then the third thing that we learn about him, he loved him while he was away, because it says that he watched and he waited for his son to come back home. I think it's a beautiful picture. It's the dad who gets up in the morning and he goes and he walks out onto the porch and he looks down the road that leads to the house to see if maybe today's the day his son's coming back. And he looks and he waits and he doesn't come back, and he goes about his business and he turns again and he looks and he waits and he still doesn't come back. And the next day, what does he do? He does the same thing day after day after day. He loved him while he was away. Let me invite you to turn back to an Old Testament book. It's where your pages are still stuck together. It's Hosea. The prophet Hosea, chapter 11 and verse 1. Listen to what God says. "When Israel was a child, I loved him. And out of Egypt, I called my son." And they called them, and so they went and they sacrificed to the Baals and they burned incense to carved images. And then God reflects, "I taught Ephraim how to walk, and I took them up in my arms, but they didn't know that I healed them. I drew them with gentle cords, with bands of love, and I was to them as those who take the yoke from off of their neck, and I stooped down to feed them." The picture is of a loving father teaching a child how to walk. He takes him by the hands, and he steps gently, step by step by step with his child. The child falls, he scoops the child up in his arms and he circles them with love. The child is hungry, he puts food before the child. And all of this is a picture of Israel while they were living contrary to God's will. And God says, "How can I give you up?" God's heart was kindled within him. His emotions were turned. Look at verse 8. He says, "How can I give you up, Ephraim? How can I hand you over, Israel? How can I make you like Admah, and how can I set you like Zebulun? My heart is churning within me, and my sympathy is stirred." You see, God says, here is this son who's gone off and wasted his life, and his dad is eaten up inside. He's torn up over his son. When Israel had done wrong and sinned before God, it tore him up. And the father loved him when he returns. The son surely had some kind of angst about him, as all of us would. We're going to go back to dad and ask, after already we've told him, "I wish you were dead. Give me my inheritance." He goes back and the father runs and throws his arms around him and falls on his neck and kisses him and is thankful to God that his son has returned unto him. He brings a ring and a robe and he throws a party for his son. He forgave him and he restored him and he celebrated with him. And he encouraged others to rejoice and celebrate as well. That's the picture of the Father. And so what I want to leave you with this morning is, our God is amazing. The Father could have stood there with hands on his hips and said, "Oh, you're hungry now, huh? What happened to the money you had? What happened to the silver? What happened to the gold that you... So why come groveling, calling back now? Why come crawling back to me? I thought you didn't want to live here. I thought you didn't want any of this." But the Father doesn't do that. The Father runs to him, throws his arms around him, celebrates with him, and encourages others to celebrate as well. Our God is amazing. You know, we have been blessed here. The last 5 weeks, we've had 4 people who've been baptized into Jesus Christ, who looked and said in one aspect or another of their life, "My life is not where it needs to be." They reflected. They resolved to make a change, and they did it. And that's a great thing. That's a wonderful thing that all of us should celebrate with them as God and the angels celebrate. What an amazing God we serve. Now, go back again to the first part of chapter 15 of Luke, because the people were complaining that Jesus was hanging around with sinful people. And Jesus tells 3 stories to say, you know what? God rejoices that I'm doing that. And I want to tell you, you and I need to spend more time with those who are in the world. We need to reach out to those who are in sin and living in that fashion in their life. Because God, this amazing God, is the God of second and third and fourth and fifth chances over and over again. Hebrews chapter 4, beginning at verse 14, listen to this beautiful passage. It says, "Seeing then that we have a great high priest," he's talking about Jesus, "who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our confession. For we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize." That in English is a double negative, which it means we do have a high priest who can sympathize with our weaknesses. And he was in all points tempted like we are, yet without sin. But look at verse 16. "Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help us in time of need." You see, this great, amazing God says, "Come to me, all you who labor and carry heavy burdens. I'll give you rest." This same amazing God says it doesn't matter where you've gone, what you've done, who you are, what's been in your life, that if you'll reflect on that and resolve to come to him and return today, you can be baptized into Jesus Christ and have every single sin you've ever committed washed away. In fact, the Apostle Paul says that once you come up out of the water of baptism, you're raised to walk in newness of life. If you want to repent today and you want to put your life in God's hands, it'd be a thrill for us to take part in that and help you. If you're not a Christian and you want to be baptized into Jesus Christ, please, please, resolve to do that. Let us help you if we can. If you need to come back and ask for the prayers of this group, let us serve you in that way. We'd be happy to pray with you and for you. However we can be of service, let's stand and sing, and we invite you to come.
Restore.
Light the fire, Lord, deep in my heart.
Please be seated. I have a few announcements to make today. First of all, thank you for that lesson, Jody. Great job. Never get tired of hearing about God's wonder and God's grace. If you've not already gotten an announcement sheet, please pick one up. And I have just a few more to add to that. First of all, happy to announce that we have a new family among us, Aiden and Kaylee Mitchell, and they're sitting right back here, have asked to be a part of us here, and they have a son, Robbie. So please welcome the Mitchells when you can. And if you were not here Wednesday night, not only did you miss a great lesson, but you missed seeing a new sister baptized into Christ. Amber Shea was baptized Wednesday evening. She's sitting right over here on the Shea row right there. And so if you're not already, please welcome her to the family as well. We have a sick list on the announcement sheet, but please add this to your list. Sue Kamrat had two surgeries Thursday and Friday. She is an HCA downtown, room 380, and she had back surgeries. And so she was in a lot of pain yesterday, but Jim said she's doing better today and she can have short visits. So please do what you can there. Also, Marie Scott, this is Dane's mother, is an HCA as well. She is awaiting plans for her treatment, a heart treatment. So please keep her in your prayers. In addition to that, Nate Forbes told me this morning that he's going to be starting a new round of chemotherapy and ask for our prayers on his behalf. So please do that, and we pray that God will be merciful and give him an easy time during that. As Jed mentioned earlier today, young men will be conducting the service tonight, and there will be a family meeting after that. So please be here, and we'll get you up to date on everything that's going on. Let's see here. Wednesday night, summer series. Brother John Gazzetta will be here, and he'll be talking about, if he is a good God, why is there evil? So another great question that he'll talk about. So please be here Wednesday night for that. Also, next Sunday afternoon, first of all, we'll start our small groups, as was mentioned earlier. But after that, the bridge service at 2 o'clock. So if you're in a small group, you might have to leave a little bit early, but come on out to the bridge and take part in that service out there with them. And I have a couple things to read. First of all, a card from Norma Neal. It says, "Dear family, thank you for your loving prayers and concerns for my family. I was very much encouraged by the card from the Thursday Bible class. All is well. Scott and I have helped Glenn move out of Alabama into Tennessee. He still plans to snowbird to his place in Florida each winter, so I will be able to be over there in the fall and winter holidays. It has been a blessing to me to be part of this loving group of Christians. Your sister in Christ, Norma Neal." And again, thank you for all your help during that time. As most of you know, a few weeks back, our brother Gary Earhart passed away. And if you knew Gary, the years he was here, you couldn't help but love the man and love what he stood for and what he showed to everybody. Elaine handed me this letter that she'd asked me to read to the family. "If you're reading this, we as a family opted not to have a memorial service when that time comes and the Lord calls us home. Because Gary and I are so close, we have opted to combine our farewell, even if one of us remains. At the time either or both of us passed from this life, our bodies have been donated to medical research at Shands Hospital, and eventually our remains will be sprinkled over the Gulf of Mexico. Instead of a funeral or a memorial service, we are writing this ahead of time to those we know and love to say thank you for sharing this journey we call life with us. This may seem strange to some of you, but we wanted you to have closure, and this is our way of saying goodbye as we leave the temporary and enter the eternal. Both Gary and myself are so thankful to have had so many amazing people in our lives. Thank you for loving us where we were to where we needed to be. Thank you for your prayers and concern during the years of physical challenges. Most of all, thank you for helping us grow in Christ while enjoying every day that God gave us a breath. We have laughed with many of you and cried with others of you. We have shared joy and sorrow, good times and challenges, crazy moments and laughter beyond measure. Many of you know Christ and have named him as your Lord and Savior and have been obedient to him and are walking with him. We have enjoyed such a sweet, sweet fellowship. Some of you have not accepted Christ as your Savior, and we long for you to come to him and give your life to him, and we can spend eternity together in his presence. Jesus himself said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me." John 14:6. Someone told us, "We don't care where you've been. We just care where you're going." Life kind of comes down to that in the end. Some of you have known us most of our lives, and others of you are new family or new friends. Regardless of the length of days that we have shared, we are so thankful that our paths crossed and our journeys was enriched because you were in it. There's no way to name names without missing someone precious to us. So we will leave it to this. Thank you for taking time to know us, and we hope the memories you have of us are good ones. Stay faithful until the Lord calls you home. None of us know when that day will come, so be ready. We wish we could tell you what that journey into the presence of Christ was like, but we cannot. But in faith, we know that God is in it, so we are in it. We can talk about what it was like in eternity. If you were a part of their lives, you know what a sermon their life was to us. Please pray for Elaine. Please pray for all of us. We can be the kind of people God wants us to be. We're going to have a closing song, and then we'll be dismissed in prayer. Let's all stand together.
You know so me, Mrs. My
come to you after a great lesson, a great letter written as well that impacts a lot of people in here. People that were part of this church that made an impact in a lot of people. throughout the many years. And Lord, like the song we sang earlier this morning of your love and your grace and your mercy, it just gives us hope and hope to take out of these doors and to take out into the world. Like the sermon, the lesson this morning, the prodigal son, we see you on the porch and as we return, that you may look back and you see us and we see success and you saying, well done, good and faithful servant. So Lord, as people are traveling or people are away from here, as people are lost or are yet to be found, we pray for them. And we pray for us as well that we can reach out to them and bring them closer. Lord, guide, guard, and protect us each and every day. And we pray for the wisdom to be transformed by the renewing of our minds. Lord, we ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.